We have been studying in this series the kingdom of the occult in specific categories. We've studied the Bible and psychic phenomena. We've gone through extrasensory perception and parapsychology. We've discussed hypnosis, the medical and the occultic. We've tried to analyze Rosicrucianism and theosophy. And we have put under the searchlight of God's Word the Church of Satan and the Satanic Bible. Tonight, we're going to be looking at the tools of the occult. What they are, how they operate, what they can tell us, how to detect, to understand, and to combat. And then, most important of all, how to evangelize. Because the name of the game is evangelism. The name of the game is to bring men and women who are in the kingdom of the occult and the cults to a redemptive knowledge of Jesus Christ. And if we fail in this, then no matter how acute and powerful our arguments may be, how great our grasp of Scripture and the depth of our intellectual perception, we will have failed to accomplish the task that God has sent us to do. We are in the world as ambassadors to bring men to Christ. Therefore, it's important for us to see these things in their proper perspective. In psychic phenomena, we have seen that we are surrounded on every side by the forces of darkness. And it's good for us to recognize that when these things occur, such as weeping Madonnas and flying crockery and moving furniture and slamming doors and opening windows, that we are dealing with other dimensional forces and that we do have the tools to deal with them. We are not either powerless or helpless, but God has not given us the spirit of bondage again to fear, but He has given us power to overcome the forces of darkness. With the extrasensory perception and the parapsychology, we focused upon the fact that there is the normal ESP, latent perhaps in all men, and we traced parapsychology back to its proper roots, which is an actual investigation of psychic phenomena, and that the Duke University studies were financed with the idea of attempting to go into another dimension to ascertain and confirm life beyond death. I think it's quite significant also that as we have studied hypnotism and the medical applications of it as well as the occultic, we can see that something which is normally good can be easily perverted to gross evil. And therefore, it's terribly important for us to understand the nature of the thing and what it is precisely that we're dealing with. When we went into the Rosicrucians and reincarnation and theosophy and the concepts which today pervade the Gnostic philosophies of the world, we could see how there were common denominators, the impersonality of God, for one, which always stood between the Christian and these things. And then, as we tonight analyze the tools of the occult, we will come to understand better the workings of Satan, whom we just analyzed last night, and the whole concept behind the forces of darkness in their operation today. Drawing all these strings together is no easy job in a one-week period. But the attempt is made with the idea in mind that we grasp the seriousness of what occultism is. It is something which can enslave the mind and possess the soul. And therefore, the Christian must be aware of it and be prepared to deal with it. Tonight, the tools of the occult will be examined in the light of the Scriptures. In order for us to understand what we're talking about when we say tools of the occult, and I might add, I can't go into all of them because there are about 108 pages of occultic tools and definitions, and we just don't have time to go through them. I have chosen some of the more common ones that we're aware of. When we go into the tools of the occult, we want to understand that they're not new, that these things are very ancient, and that they go back into the roots of Babylonian religion, Chaldean religion, and Egyptian religion, and that we can find the sources of modern occultism far back in antiquity. It is no accident that the Jews themselves were warned by God in Deuteronomy chapter 18 not to imitate the pagan cultures in the land that God gave them, because if they did, they would receive the same judgment. And listed were the very things we have been studying in the kingdom of the occult. How many have your Bibles with you tonight? Good. We're going to need them. But before we get into that, let's take some of the common tools. Let's define them so we know what they are. And then let's analyze them in the light of the Scripture. And then get to the spiritual antidote to occultic tools. The first tool of the occult, which is very common, is tarot cards. Now, there are approximately 78 specially marked cards, and these are used to foretell the future. In other words, a person who has tarot card readings is looking for a picture of the future. And the person who claims to be able to interpret the tarot cards, which looks very innocent on the surface, is really saying, I can tell you something about your future that you don't now know. So the person who says, why don't you have a tarot card reading, is really saying, why don't you go into fortune telling? Because the tarot card is an attempt to penetrate beyond this dimension. So when you see anybody talking about tarots, you'll know what they're talking about, a specially designed card which is supposed to hold the key to your future and to events which will influence your life. Now, there's a second tool of the occult, which we've mentioned before, but which ought to be emphasized, and that's known as the Ouija board. This is a flat wooden board with an alphabet circular around the top of it, and a pointer generally made of plastic or some other material that points and spells out answers to questions. Now, there's a young gentleman here tonight who had some interesting experiences with a Ouija board, and I have made allusion to this at other times when I have lectured on the subject, but it's worth mentioning because these things do occur. I was lecturing not too long ago in New Jersey at a Christian high school, and they had asked me to come in and lecture on the occult because some of the kids in the high school, in a Christian high school, were dabbling in the Ouija board and in the tarot cards and in some of the other tools of the occult, and so they felt it was a very good idea if they found out what it was all about. So I came in and I spent an entire day. I lectured 7.5 hours. I went from class to class to class, repeating and expanding lectures and answering questions on the subject, and the entire day was rescheduled for this particular thing. We had about 800 students involved in this. And you should have seen the looks of surprise when some of the students started to get up and confirm from their experience what I was talking about. One student got up and he said, I don't want to spend a lot of time. He said, but I was into the Ouija board myself. And you could see some of the other kids, oh, they're all shook up. I mean, this is a Christian boy from a Christian family. I mean, this just doesn't happen in Christian schools. It's happening in Christian schools all over this country. He said, I was into the Ouija board, and he said, I started spelling out certain things and trying to get some answers. And he said, I was having a lot of fun because something was moving my hand. And it was moving it and spelling things out for me, and I thought it was great fun. He said, finally, he said, I decided to ask it a religious question. So I said to the Ouija, do you know Jesus Christ? Who is he? And the Ouija board shook a little bit, and the plastic spinner went sailing off the board and bounced off the wall of my bedroom. He said, at that juncture, I decided that if I were serious about Christianity, it was no sense playing with the Ouija board because it didn't want to have anything to do with Jesus. And so I burned the thing. He said, but I got messages from that to various answers to various questions that I addressed and my with other people present, and our hands were being moved. We were not doing it ourselves. He said, but when I was alone that time and I asked the question about Jesus, he said, that plastic marker just sailed right off the board and I never laid a finger on it. and bounced off the wall. He said, very uncooperative Ouija board when it came to Jesus Christ. And then this young gentleman who's here this evening who had an experience with him interrogated a Ouija board at length, trying to find out the spirit behind the Ouija board and who it was and so forth. And the spirit was quite cooperative up to a point. Gave its name as Yes. That's pleasant because they have other names too. And he asked questions, biblical questions, which the other person manipulating the board couldn't possibly have known the answer to because they were not biblically oriented. But the spirit that was moving it around knew the answers. And the answers were coming pretty rapidly. They got to the subject of Jesus Christ, of course. It was an entirely different ball game, particularly when it came to the resurrection. And to the gentleman who was asking the questions, and the Ouija board, in no uncertain terms, informed him that it didn't love him, it hated him, and had no respect whatsoever for the Christian gospel. On another occasion, he also indicated that encounter with the same spirit behind the Ouija board produced some more events worthwhile and worth analyzing. You don't play with Ouijas, even if Parker Brothers, who produce Monopoly, tell you it's fun. You don't buy them and you don't play with them because this is one of the ways into the world of the occult. You must grasp the significance of this sentence. We are surrounded by another dimension of reality that is not subject to the senses, but is nevertheless as real as anything material. And it is capable of penetrating our dimension in given instances and of doing things contrary to the laws which govern our dimension. Table levitation, trumpet levitation, all types of phenomena can be accomplished. And this dimension is under the personal control, the scripture tells us, of the prince of the powers of the air, that spirit who works in the children of disobedience. It's an amazing thing to see people selling their souls for a chair that is 6 inches off the floor, or a trumpet that's buzzing around a room. Big deal. The devil can move something. The devil can tell you something. The devil can do something unusual. Why should we be shook up about things like this? If he levitated the microphone in this room right now, it shouldn't come as any shock to anybody, nor should it cause us to put our faith in him. His parlor tricks do not match the power of God. Satan doesn't open up the Red Sea so you walk through on dry land. Satan doesn't consume sacrifices on Mount Carmel so that the people proclaim that Jehovah is God. Satan is not involved in the business of really doing things the right way. He is a very sleazy imitator of the real thing. The people who are involved in the psychic phenomena kick and in the Ouija boards and in penetrating this dimension are really selling their souls for very cheap manifestations. I wouldn't sell my soul for anything less than opening up the Pacific. And since he's really not in that business, I know I'm perfectly safe. But this is what we are up against. Forces of darkness operative in our dimension. And people have to recognize that they're real. This is part of the equipment of the occult. You get into it slowly, and before you know it, you are in a position where you cannot help yourself. Then we have the famous crystal ball, which is used to see the future through occultic powers. What do you see when you look in a crystal ball? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. You can look in Gene Dixon's crystal ball and you won't see a thing. You can look in a medium's crystal ball and you won't see a thing. Because the only people that see things in crystal balls are those that have occultic revelations. And you're going to ask me, I'm sure, do you really believe that things appear in those crystal balls? Absolutely. And I believe in dreams and visions in the world of the occult. And I firmly believe that the devil is a magnificent magician, and that he has been playing the shell game with the human race ever since the Garden of Eden. Now you see it, now you don't. Under which shell is reality? You never find out. But he is the master of illusion. And dealing with the devil is not an easy task. As one of the medieval personages of great intellectual prowess who reminds us that whoever wants to sup with Satan had better have a long spoon, because it's not good to get too close. The crystal ball is a way of trying to penetrate. And this is what Jean Dixon uses it for. She says that she receives impressions through her crystal ball. And when she looked in her crystal ball, she saw a shadow over the White House, which symbolized the death of a Democratic president who was to be elected in 1960. And then she said that she foresaw the arrival of Antichrist, a la crystal ball, and a talking snake that visits her on occasions and slithers up the bed, wraps around her, and communicates supernatural information. As I've said on a number of occasions, I have always been suspicious of talking snakes. Therefore, I think Mrs. Dixon ought to turn off the crystal ball and turn on the scriptures, because this is the real source of revelation. Anybody that is looking for reality will find that reality in the living God. They're not going to find that reality in some circle of crystal where somebody is looking and saying, this is going to happen. God is the master of the future, not the crystal ball. But this is one of the common tools of the occult. And then there's psychometry. Now, most people don't know what psychometry is. But psychometry is the capacity to take an object that belongs to a person and then to tell that person positively amazing things about himself or herself through the vibrations coming from the object. This explains the various mystics, Quasay and others, who can pick up objects and tell you precisely what the person is doing or where they are, or even if they're alive or dead. Dr. Kurt Koch has an interesting observation which I thought I might share with you on the subject of psychometry, and a very good case that's worth citing. He tells the story concerning a clairvoyant, this is Quasay, who lectured on experimental clairvoyance in Germany. And he asked the audience to give him some articles, anything that they wanted, clothing or anything else. And then he proceeded to hold them in his hand and describe things about the people in their lives that only they could have known. But Dr. Cox says the most interesting observation he's been able to make on the subject of psychometry concerns an incident in World War II. I'll quote his case history. During the war, the father of a minister had been missing for 3 years. The family did not know whether he was dead or alive. One day a student visited them. He heard that their father was missing and asked them to give him something which had belonged to the father. They gave him the last postcard they had received. The student concentrated on the card and then said, "He's still alive. He's a prisoner of war somewhere in northern Siberia." He then went so far as to point out the place on a map of Russia. Only later, after the father had returned, did the family discover that he had in fact been kept prisoner at the exact spot where the student indicated on the map. This is psychometry. Allegedly, the capacity to receive a vibration from a postcard, a piece of jewelry, whatever it may be, to tell you something about the person. Now, this is a common tool of the occult. To set your mind at ease, the real source of the information is not any vibration coming out of a postcard, or a shoe, or a ring, or anything else. The real source of psychometric manifestation is a spirit that communicates information. And this is what you're up against in the world of the occult. People are awed by an individual that can hold a letter opener in their hand and say, "This belongs to Cousin Willie. He lives in Oshkosh, in the third house on Main Street, and he's bald, 5 feet five, and is a charter member of the Elks, and wears a big tooth on a chain." And sure enough, it does belong to Cousin Willie, and all of those things are true. And the person instantaneously jumps to the wholly unwarranted conclusion that all of that information, including the Elk's tooth, came out of the letter opener, which it did not. It comes instead from forces latent within that individual, revealed to that person because they are practicing a form of occultism. And our mistake is in saying, "Oh, isn't that amazing? I wonder how it's done." Don't ever say that. It is amazing, but you know how it's done. And God is not in the business of psychometry. He is in the business of revelation, which is a big difference. And God doesn't do parlor tricks. God is interested in men's souls and in human destiny. That's far different than the little parlor tricks that are supposed to attract our attention. Let me illustrate just what I mean by this. In New York, a few years ago, we had a story in one of our major newspapers about a picture on the wall of a house in Long Island, which was attracting enormous interest. What was the picture doing? Minding its own business, hanging on the wall? No, it was crying at regular intervals. Real salt tears. Now somebody's saying, "Oh, come on now. You don't really believe it." I certainly do. Why do I believe it? Because they sent people out there, and when it was crying, they took some of the fluid from the picture. It was a picture of the Virgin Mary or some saint. And they analyzed it, and it was real tears. And immediately, they had candles around the picture and an altar under the picture, and everybody was coming in and kneeling down and going through the various gesticulations in front of the picture. And it was in the papers for weeks. A weeping picture. Now, Billy Graham could come to New York and preach Jesus Christ in Madison Square Garden for 18 weeks, and they would cover the crusade on page 75, paragraph 4, near the bottom, which would carefully note that 80 people came forward to make a decision for Christ. But after 18 weeks, you wouldn't see anything about people's lives being changed. Drug addicts and prostitutes and people on all levels of life having an encounter with God that was doing something to vitally alter their lives and the lives of others. That you would never see anything about. But this picture hanging on the wall that's sobbing every once in a while has an altar underneath it with people praying. Why do you suppose this is true? Because people are impressed by pictures that are not supposed to cry, and not by people who are. This is the great callousness and dilemma of our age. More attention is paid to a picture than to the soul of a man. And once you put it in its proper perspective, you can see it for what it really is. That picture was not weeping because God Almighty decided to have a revival on Long Island and began the revival by having weeping pictures. He's not in that business. He's in the business of saving human souls and reconstructing battered lives. And thus he did so love us as to send Christ to effect that. But you see, this great tool of the occult that we see on every side gets our mind off the person of Christ. And we look at the mystic and the person, and we fail to realize, in contrast, it's nothing nothing compared to the magnificence of the Master. So Dr. Koch is perfectly correct. Psychometry does take place, but the magician behind the psychometry is not human, but supernatural. Then there's a fifth tool of the occult. We see it all around us. Amulets, charms, and fetishes. An object which is allegedly imbued with occultic power to protect the owner from evil. You can't go into a drugstore today. You can't go into a notions counter. You can't go anywhere without being able to buy the signs of the zodiac, without being able to buy the Ankh, which is the Egyptian cross of life, the circle on the top and the cross beneath it, which is the symbol of satanic power, an ancient Egyptian demon symbol. You can't go in without picking up some form of fetish or amulet that's supposed to bring the wearer protection or good luck. And the terrible thing about this is that the cross of Jesus Christ has now reached that stage too. People are buying the cross and wearing it on the same basis that they would buy anything devilish and wear it. Because the cross has lost its meaning. It has become a fetish, a charm, or an amulet in the minds of a secular world. That's why I'm wondering whether or not Christians ought not to make a very sincere, dedicated, and consistent effort to emphasize precisely what the meaning of the cross is. And let people know that whoever wears a cross is testifying to the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the fact that he lives and that he is our intercessor before the Father. Then, of course, we have palmistry. I'll never forget riding down one of our freeways in New York, and as I was driving off it, I noticed an enormous sign that said fortune telling and palm reading. And you could go in and pay a dollar, and Madam Who's-This-What's-It, or whatever her name was, would read the lines in your hand and tell you what your future was. I was out here in California, and I thought I'd never find something like that in California. But I was riding down one of your freeways, and I didn't see a sign. I saw a big hand. I thought it was somebody holding their hand up off the freeway saying, stop. There's a great big hand sticking up off the freeway. Must have been at least 10 feet high. And across the palm of the hand, it says, palm reading and advisor. So you go on into this place, and I don't know how much it costs in California, but they read your hand too. And if you go in, it's quite interesting. They tell you that this line represents your birth line, and this represents your lifeline, and this line represents when you're going to die. Never forget one time a palm reader, before I was involved in what I'm in now, took a look at my palm and was supposed to give a reading. So I held my hand out, and they looked. This particular woman looked in my hand, and she said, oh, oh. I said, what is it? Something terrible certainly had occurred. She said, I've never seen a lifeline like yours. I said, you haven't? She said, no. She said, it's the longest lifeline I've ever seen. It begins here, and it ends here, and you have only two major illnesses in your entire life. And you know, I've been worried about my health ever since. And how long I'm going to live. Because when you get that kind of information from the occult, you worry. The devil is not interested in my lifespan except in terminating it as rapidly as possible. So what is palmistry? And yours too, so don't laugh at me. Remember, we are strangers and pilgrims in this world. We are aliens. Our source of supply and life comes from above. And we are here as invaders of a satanic kingdom, ambassadors of an alien court, to bring the gospel of reconciliation to a dying age. Our home is in heaven. We seek a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. And so let us not forget that we have all a priority on the satanic list for removal. Because each Christian is potentially a reproducing agent for more Christians. The next best thing to a damned soul is a sterile Christian who does not reproduce spiritually and bring people into the kingdom of God. If Satan cannot have your soul, he will do everything possible to sterilize your life. So he can say to you, you're in a fine position to tell other people about your faith. Look at the mess you've made out of your life. You just better shut up. Anybody here ever heard that voice? What do you expect? We are in the army of the Lord, invading this kingdom. Naturally, we're going to be under attack. God hasn't called us to a Sunday school picnic. He called us the full-scale war. And I'm amazed at the number of Christians who think that the Christian life is a picnic. They raise their hands in the meeting, they go down front, they accept Jesus as their Savior, and from that time on, they're going to walk on cloud 11 until He comes back again. Whatever it is, it's not Christian theology. Because Christian theology teaches us that Jesus Christ is capable of meeting all the needs of our lives. That He is sufficient and His Spirit and His power can deliver us. But it also teaches us that we are weak and sinful and degenerate and we have an Adamic nature. That nobody's going to live on Mount Everest forever. The inevitable valleys can only be leveled by the power of God's Spirit. We ought to remember that the Christian life is a battle. Ephesians 6 says, put on the whole armor of God. Does that sound like we're going to a Sunday school picnic? To put on the armor of God means to fight against our carnal nature, against the forces of darkness, and against all those things that would neutralize and destroy us. And the tools of the occult are right out there in the front of us, touching people on every side. And if we don't recognize them, how will we deal with them? And then we have the constant practice of dowsing. Everybody looks at dowsing and they laugh and they say, you don't really believe anybody can douse, do you? That they can take a stick and walk around with it and actually find water? You really believe that happened? Yeah, I really believe that happened. Why? Because dowsers are water witches. We have one of them right here in one of our national magazines. Now, this witch has a twitch. That's what the heading says. For water. He has had this gift because it was handed down in his family who are occultists. And he is the only one of the family that now possesses the gift. He takes a Y-shaped green willow branch and goes out looking for water. And when he gets to where there is water, and people have seen this happen, his hands are out straight like this, and the center shaft is pointing forward, and all of a sudden, without him moving his hands, the dowsing agent, the wood, will turn in his hands and point downward. He is not doing it. What is? Wood is not subject to magnetism. Water does not attract twigs unless they're on tree trunks. It's therefore obvious that something is operative. He says there is something operative. My technique has never been wrong. I have always found water. How does he get this information? The spirits tell him. They move the wood and locate the water. He said, well, things like this don't happen. Things like this do happen. And they are checked and double-checked, and the guy repeats it dozens of times so you can see it happen, and he never misses. Who do you think is doing this? God isn't in the business of locating wells for people. He has sunk the greatest of all wells at the cross, that out of our innermost being may flow the rivers of living water that will bubble up to everlasting life. That's the well of God, His Spirit. But water witching is very common, and people laugh about it. Don't laugh. It's one of the commonest tools of the occult. It's called dowsing. And, of course, I know you're familiar with horoscopes. You see them in every store. You know what they are. Astrology and the casting of horoscopes, very common. I know Christians that come to me quietly after meetings when their pastor isn't around, and they say, you don't really think there's anything wrong with horoscopes, do you? or I'm not really into astrology, but I am interested. Some amazing things have happened to me because of astrology. Well, some amazing things can happen to you because of astrology, particularly if you start having faith in astrology instead of in the God who created the stars. Astrology gets our mind off the Creator and onto the creation. And anything that does that is in danger of what Paul says in Romans chapter 1. God condemned the world because they worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. This is what we find about us on every side today. Quite literally, governing our lives by the stars. That is not what the Scripture says. This is one of the constant tools of the occult. A horoscope is a diagram of the various planetary positions and the stars relative to the signs of the zodiac. It is utilized to cast horoscopes of the future. I've been saying all of these things, these eight common signs of the occult and tools. Have you noticed something common to almost all of them? They are all absorbed with the penetration of what? The future. Now, this is something that the world of the occult always holds out to people. The tarot card is going to tell you your future. The crystal ball is going to help you with your future. Psychometry is going to locate something that has an effect upon you and your future. Dowsing is obviously going to affect your future because you're going to believe in the forces that reveal the sources of water. And you're going to get interested in these things. All of these things show preoccupation with one thing, the future. And it's because of this that we must turn to the Scriptures to analyze the tools of the occult. I'd like you to take your Bibles, and I'd like you to see what God has to say on the subject of the occult and the tools which it utilizes. It's a very common thing for the Ouija board to be used as a means of communicating with the spirit world to get information, a sort of one-man seance. People are interested in contacting other spirits, and there are other spirits that can be contacted. But Isaiah 8:19 should be underlined in every Bible, because the world of the occult emphasizes seance and Ouija as a means of what? Contact with forces beyond this dimension. Now, the King James Bible does not do this justice, so I'm going to give it to you from the Hebrew the way it actually reads. Isaiah chapter 8, verse 19. It's a very important passage, and it should be underlined and memorized. God spoke to his people and said, "When they shall say unto you, seek for them that have familiar spirits," or those who are mediums possessed by devils, "and unto witches," a male witch, "that chirp and mutter," talking now about trying to attempt communication, "should not a people seek unto their God?" Should not a people seek unto their God? Now this King James says, notice it carefully, "for the living to the dead," doesn't read that way. It actually reads, "should not a people seek unto their God," or "should not the living not seek the dead?" Of course, it's forbidden. What he's saying is stay away from it. The King James makes it appear as what? If you want to find out about the dead, well then, you should at least seek it from God. But that's not what the passage is saying. The passage is forbidding anybody to attempt to get this information. And it's in the form of a question. Shouldn't the people seek from God? They should not, is the answer. Seek for the dead through the living. That's exactly what God is communicating. So we're being told that when you're playing with a Ouija board or attempting a seance, what are you doing? You are going contrary to what God warned the Jews about, and you are reaching out to penetrate. And if you reach out for that penetration, the Scripture says, You go contrary to the revelation of God. It is both an anti-Ouija and an anti-seance passage, if you want to put it that way. God simply says, don't do it. Now, a good modern translation will give you exactly the same thing. There are different variations of the reading, but it comes out the same way. It's in a question form. But the answer to the question is in the negative. Don't do it. God is against it. Now, there's a whole compilation of evidence on the views of God on the tools of the occult and penetrating the future. And all of these things are given to us for a purpose. The purpose of showing us that we cannot, we dare not, enter into a relationship which can have great spiritual dangers for us. In 2 Kings 21, verse 6, you may care to make a notation of this. 2 Kings 21, 6, 2 Chronicles 33, 6. Occultic practices brought ruin upon King Manasseh's kingdom, so that God judged him for utilizing tools of the occult. We ought to take a good lesson from this. Stay away from it, because if God brought judgment on his own king because of it, then we can expect judgment if we become involved in it. So mark the references, they're worth knowing. 2 Kings 21:6, 2 Chronicles 33:6. Manasseh's downfall was the direct result of the tools of the occult. I think perhaps one of the most powerful passages is found in Isaiah chapter 47. I've made mention of this on a number of occasions. I never tire of it simply because God has specifically told us, remember it. Keep it in your mind. Don't forget it. It is a warning that nobody who prizes the Word of God can ignore. Stand now with thine enchantments. That's a tool of the occult, an amulet, or some type of talisman or fetish, some type of spell. That's a tool. Stand now with thine enchantment and with the multitude of thy sorceries, crystal balls, and seances, wherein you have labored from your youth. If so be, you shall be able to profit. If so be, you may prevail. You are wearied in the multitude of your counsels. Let now the astrologers, the stargazers, and the monthly prognosticators stand up and save you from these things that shall come upon you. Notice the lumping together of the world of the occult. The astrologer, the stargazer, the person who casts the horoscope, another tool of the occult. Let these people stand up and save you, Israel. They shall be as stubble. The fire shall burn them. They shall not deliver themselves from the power of the flame. Now, the tools of the occult cannot save the occultist. Therefore, says God, they certainly won't save you. The only thing that's going to save you is me, says the Lord. So don't get led off into these things. I know how easy it is to be led off into the world of the occult. Across this nation and around the world, as I have traveled and interviewed people, I have met person after person as a Christian who has been sucked into the world of the occult. Out of Christian churches, out of Christian fellowship, people hanging in some sort of theological and spiritual limbo, terrified and fruitless. And the Scripture is consistently trying to tell us, listen, nothing is innocent. Nothing that involves the devil is innocent. And the minute you get playing with the tools of the occult, no matter how simple they may be, then you're in for trouble. Now, beyond this, the New Testament has said a number of things on the subject of the occult. I have mentioned, of course, Acts 16, where a young maiden was possessed with the spirit of fortune-telling. That's exactly what it says, Acts 16, 16. She had the power to tell fortunes. And Paul exorcised the demon from her. What was the function of the demon that lived in the girl? To tell the future. So one of the tools of the occult is to get us interested in the future. And there are people who have made a practice of fortune telling or telling the future to others, sometimes with remarkable accuracy. What is the source of the power? There's only two sources. 1 Corinthians 12 and Acts 16:16. 1 Corinthians 12 is the gift of prophecy that comes from God the Holy Spirit. And I assure you, he is not interested in horoscopes or astrology, nor does he conduct seances. How do I know that? Acts chapter 13. The Holy Spirit filled the Apostle Paul to rebuke a sorcerer who practiced occultism. He wouldn't have filled him with power to strike the man blind if God were behind his sorceries and his occultism. It was to show the superiority of the power of God that the Holy Spirit brought judgment on the sorcerer of Acts 13. Therefore, we can say with an absolute degree of certainty that Acts 16:16 is the best possible explanation for foreseeing the future. It is a tool of occultism, and it is dangerous. All of the tools, one way or another, lead you down this primrose path to trust in powers and in forces not in any way associated with God. And finally, the Christian has a mighty tool to aid him in his witness for Christ. Now, I recognize when I say this that I run the risk of instantaneously being labeled as a Pentecostal. For any time anyone talks about the Holy Spirit today, in view of the modern charismatic movement, everybody runs for the labeling machine. And they are looking desperately to put a label on you because that's the only way their rather limited mentalities can grasp what you're talking about. So what you don't understand, you label, and after you've labeled it, then you're supposed to understand it. Nothing could be further from the truth. Labels are very dangerous and extremely misleading. Let me point out to you that in Daniel chapter 1, verse 20, that Daniel was a man filled with the Holy Spirit. In Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 5, he is master of the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers, the diviners of the future, and all of the occultists. And the reason he is, according to the book of Daniel, is because in him was the spirit of the living and holy God. Daniel's superiority was postulated upon the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Daniel 1:20 says, he was 10 times better than all the astrologers, all the soothsayers, all the sorcerers, and all the occultists under the 3 kings that he served during his apprenticeship in prophecy. 10 times better than all of them. Why? Because in him was the spirit of the Holy God. That was Daniel's secret. That's our secret too. If anything is to be known about the future, God will reveal it through his Holy Spirit. If anything is to be known, God is the source of that knowledge. And he has given us in 1 Corinthians 12 the gift of prophecy, to proclaim and to foreknow. He says this is to be coveted by the Christian. If he wants to know something, let him ask God for it. Don't file your inquiries with the devil or with the world of the occult. File them with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit antedates the Pentecostals by a long period of time. He antedates all denominations. He has been around since eternity. And therefore, I think we can say with some degree of assurance that the Holy Spirit is trustworthy and reliable in giving us information. And in 1 Corinthians 12, he gives us gifts and information. He gives faith. He gives the gift of discerning the spirits, which is knowing whether or not you're dealing with God or the devil. And the Holy Spirit gives power. He gives miracles. He gives healing. Yes, he gives tongues and their interpretation when it pleases him. But all of the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit are for the purpose of what? Building up and edifying the church, which is Jesus Christ's body. And for the purpose of demonstrating to the world that the gospel of Jesus Christ is indeed true. Hebrews chapter 2 reminds us that the apostles preached the message and the signs and wonders followed them in confirmation. We should expect nothing less from the Holy Spirit today than that he pour out upon us what is necessary for us to have in order to exist in this cosmic zoo to which we have committed ourselves as witnesses for Jesus Christ. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever, it is said of the Lord Jesus. No denomination has a corner on the Holy Spirit. But I want to tell you something. I would walk out of this church tonight and out of the ministry that God has given me in the kingdom of the cult and the occult if I did not have the complete and absolute assurance that God, the Holy Spirit, has never changed. That his power is still the same. I would be scared witless to face the forces of darkness without the full power and equipment of the Holy Spirit. And the scripture says that whoever believes in Christ and trusts him, out of their innermost being will flow the rivers of living water that will bubble up to eternal life. Thus he spake of the Spirit, who was not yet given. The Holy Spirit is not on any one gift kick. He is not giving somebody a gift so that they can have status in the church. The Holy Spirit is the dispenser of all gifts. And the command is seek from him what he chooses to bestow. And he has the power to help us face the forces that today challenge the church in every area of the world. The Christian who is not yielded to the Holy Spirit, the Christian who does not produce in his or her life the fruit of the Holy Spirit, and the Christian who is not intelligent enough to seek gifts from the Holy Spirit, will have an extremely rough time in the closing days of the age of grace. It is because power is available that God has told us greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. To counteract the tools of occultism and the forces of Satan, God has given us his Spirit. And that power is for the church till Jesus Christ returns. Your task and mine is not an easy one. But our labor is not in vain in the Lord. We are to go out and make disciples. And we are to stand against the forces of darkness, proclaiming the unsearchable riches of Christ. We dare not do this without the Holy Spirit and his power. It was he who energized the early church to greatness. He will do no less for us today. I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. I can only quote Donald Barnhouse, my own teacher, who said, come in the wind, come in the fire, come in the earthquake, come in the sound of stillness, come as thou wilt, O Spirit of God, only come, come. That is the only answer to the Prince of Darkness, the vital energy of the power of God.